For part 6, we'll explore continuous distributions and the standard normal distribution. So quick notes on probability distributions. For a continuous random variable, and that's what we'll be talking about right now, the probability that X is exactly some specific number is going to be virtually zero. In other words, if X can vary any number between 0 and 100, and it could be even decimals, the probability that you're going to find someone exactly at 32.168 is going to be virtually zero. So instead of calculating the probability of X being exactly a number, we're going to calculate the probability that X is between two different values. And that's the only way that it's going to work. To represent this, we can draw a curve, like a histogram, but just kind of smoothed out a little. And the probability that X is between two numbers is just going to be the area under that curve, the area of the shaded region. Our graph is going to have an X and Y axis. The X axis is just going to be our X values, our variable. The Y axis, we're going to use the symbol F of X for that. And you've seen the symbol F of X before, possibly in other courses. So note these F of X values don't really have a very good practical interpretation. They're not probabilities, even though they act kind of similar to them. But they do represent a function called the probability distribution function or the probability density function. In other courses, you might, and if you take more stats classes, this is often abbreviated with the symbol PDF, probability density function. And again, their values don't have a really good meaning to them, but they're picked in a way such that the whole area under the curve, if you were to shade it, would be 1, because remember, the sum of the probabilities of a distribution should be 1. All right, so first let's just go through a quick example of the uniform distribution. Note that this uniform distribution and the next example I'm going to do, triangular distribution, is not going to be on your test. I'm just going to use this to illustrate the concept of areas under the curve in PDFs. So suppose that we notice speeds on a highway vary from 50 miles an hour to 70 miles an hour, and every speed is equally likely. Now, this is not realistic, but let's just suppose this. So the chance that you see someone going 53 miles an hour is the same chance as you see someone going 68 miles an hour. They're exactly the same. So let's try to use this to find the probability that a car is traveling between 50 and 55 miles per hour. All right, so to do this, let's see if I can get this. Oops, one second. Take out my pen. Let's use black, I guess. All right, so to do this, I'm just going to draw my probability distribution function. The x-axis is over here. F of x would be up here. Okay, and I said the speeds went from 50 miles an hour all the way up to 70 miles an hour. Put that over there. And every speed is equally likely, so it's going to create this rectangular shape. Now, this is beyond the scope of this class, but this number over here would be 0.05. Don't worry about where that came from, but you'll see that this actually will work. Again, for every PDF, the whole area underneath the curve, if I were to shade in that entire rectangle, should be equal to 1. And if we do a quick check, from going from 50 to 70, that's 20, so the length of our rectangle is 20, the height is 0.5, so the whole area, the whole area under the whole curve would be 20 times 0.05, which would give you, 1. Check. So this is a PDF. All right, that's not the question, though. The question asked is, what's the probability that someone's going between 50 and 55? So we just want to find this area. How much did I shade in right there? And that's going to be the probability that a car is going between 50 and 55 miles an hour. All right, writing this up in symbols, we want to find the probability that X is between 50 and 55. Oops, 55. And the area of a triangle, of a rectangle is length times width. The length would be 5 because the difference between 50 and 55 is just 5. And the height is 0.05. You multiply those numbers together and you get 0.25. So that's the probability that a car is traveling between 50 and 55 miles an hour. Now this makes sense, and you probably could have done this with intuition, because the speeds vary, the range is 20 miles an hour, and 5 is exactly 1/4 of that. So it makes sense that 1/4 of the cars would be traveling between 50 and 55, or 25%. All right, so that concludes that example. Let's look at this next one. It's a triangular distribution. So we want to find the probability that X is between 18 to 20. So the way this triangular distribution is going to work, again, we still have the X's and the probability, or the F of X's over there. And I'm just going to draw my triangle. And it looks something like that. It should be symmetric. I'm just not great at drawing. So let's say this triangle goes from 18 to 22, and it's centered around 20. So what I'm being asked for is find this area right here. Just for reference, the top of this triangle is located at 0.5. All right, so the area of a triangle we know is 1/2 base times height. And if we do a quick check, the base of this triangle, okay, that should be an 18 over there. The base of this triangle is 4. The height of this triangle is 0.5. 4 times 0.5 is 2, and 1/2 of that would be 1. So this works. This is a probability distribution function. Okay, to actually calculate the values we want to calculate, though, we just need to figure out the base of our shaded-in triangular shape and the height of our triangular shape. So our base is going to be, let's see, 20 minus 18 is just 2, and the height of this triangle that we drew is 0.5. So let's see, 1/2 times 2 is just 1, 1 times 0.5 is 0.5. So that means that the probability that X is between 18 and 20 would be equal to 1/2, or 0.5, or 50%. Does that make sense? Well, yeah, it looks like half the triangle is shaded, so it makes sense that the probability that X is between 18 to 20 would be 1/2. And that's our answer. Okay, so this brings us to something called the normal distribution. We've actually seen this before. It's that mound-shaped and symmetrical distribution we saw earlier in the course. We saw this when we discussed the empirical rule, if you remember. One thing about the normal distribution is it is symmetric, where it's centered around the mean. And if you remember, like, one standard deviation would be about here, two standard deviations would be here, etc. All right, moving on. Let's explore something called the standard normal distribution. The standard normal distribution just takes the normal distribution we saw on the previous slide, and instead of having x values over here, you have z-scores instead. So remember, z-scores measure the number of standard deviations you are from the mean. Remember specifically the formula for our z-score was z is equal to x minus mu over sigma. So if we're one standard deviation above the mean, that means we'd have a z-score of 1. So that's why about at one standard deviation, you see a z-score of 1. Similarly, since we're talking about number of standard deviations above the mean, if you're at the mean, your z-score would be 0, right? Because it'd be mu minus mu, which is be 0 over whatever the standard deviation is. So since it's centered around 0, since the mean is 0, it's going to be centered around 0. So this is what all z-scores are, all standard normal distributions look like. Or you can just call it a z-distribution if you like. So this is the standard normal distribution, and it's very useful because it's standardized, and we can use a table to look up values. Whereas if you're just dealing with some arbitrary x value, you can't look it up on a table because the table won't know what your x's are. So this is what the z-table looks like. This is in Appendix 3 in your textbook. Again, just go to your textbook, your ebook, and there isn't an option to directly get to the appendix, but if you just click on any chapter and open it, then you can click to go directly to the appendix. All right, anyway, so here's the Z table, or part of it at least. And the Z table is a very strange table. It gives you the probability that an X, or rather a Z value, is between 0 and some number, which they call Z. So if you want to find the probability that Z is between these two numbers, you look it up on the table. All right, the reason why I say this is a very strange table is, let's say your Z score is something like 1.53. So we have two digits past the decimal place we're looking at, the tenths place and the hundredths place. So 1.53, the 1.5 is over here, and the 3 is over here. So you just look at where they match up, and that would be the probability, the 0.4370. So let's do an example. So let's use the Z table to calculate the probability that Z is between 0 and 1.24. So I'm just going to draw the curve. So you just draw the curve as best you can, label the center with a 0, and draw your line at 1.24. And I'm drawing it to the right of 0 because 1.24 is to the right of 0. And it doesn't really matter where you draw the line, it doesn't matter for the calculations at least. So let's pull up our Z table, look up 1.24 on it. So there's 1.2, the 4 would be down that column, and we get 0.3925. So the probability Z is between 0 and 1.24 would be 0.3925. So shade that in, and that's our probability. All right, so let's try to find the probability that z is less than 2.13. Now, one thing to note is our table really doesn't give us this directly, right? It gives us the probability that it's between 0 and 2.13. So to start this off, let's just draw the curve, and I highly recommend doing this. Okay, and again, our z score centered around 0, and our z is this axis. So 2.13 would be on the right. Again, it doesn't really matter where you draw it as long as it's on the right. Sorry, 2.13. And we want to find this area, the area to the left of 2.13. Well, we have to use a little bit of instinct here, just some basic knowledge of geometry. The idea is that we know this curve is symmetric, so half the curve should be over here and half should be over here. So since the entire side left of 0 is shaded in, we know that should be 0.5 because half the curve should be over there. So we just now need to figure out this part. Well, we can look that up on the table because the table gives us the area between 0 and 2.13. So doing that, let's see, we have 2.1, go over to 3. And we get the number 0.4834. So this number would just be 0.4834. Well, let's see. So we add together to figure out the entire region. Half is on one side, and then part of the other would be 0.4834. So just do 0.4834 plus 0.5 gives you 0.9834. So that's our answer. The probability z is between zero, sorry, between well, negative infinity and 2.13, or less than 2.13 would be a better way of phrasing it, is 98.34%. Okay, let's look at this example. Let's find the probability that z is less than negative 1.93. So bringing up our table again, I'm going to draw my curve. And don't worry if your curves don't look this nice. I have about 10 years of practice on this. More, actually. Okay, so centered around Z. I'm sorry, centered around 0. And, well, negative would be to the left of 0. So negative 1.93 would be somewhere over here. And since we want to find the probability Z is less than that, we're going to shade to the left. Okay, again, our table doesn't give us this area. It gives us the area between two numbers. And really, our table only gives us areas that look like this, between 0 and some positive z value. But because of symmetry, this area would have to be equal to the area on the other side. So let's find the area between 0 and positive 1.93, because that will be the same as the area between 0 and negative 1.93. So looking on the table, this area, let's see, so 1.9 would be over here, and we want to go over to 3, the 3 column, which is over there, so we get 0.4732. A little darker. All right. So that area is 0.4732, but we know the whole left side has to be 0.5, so we can use subtraction. So just 0.5 minus 0.4732 will give you 0.0268. And that's our answer. The probability that Z is less than negative 1.93 would be 0.0268. And if you add these up, you can check that it would equal 1/2.